Good afternoon, everybody. I hope there was a gap of about 4 days. I hope all of you reviewed the first 2 days' lecture, especially two notions. I will quickly recall, and I think we stopped at an example. We will continue with that. Let me share the screen. So I hope all of you remember the following. On R2, we had a distance of between 2 points. X comma Y, A comma B was defined to be X minus A whole squared plus, this is the Pythagorean distance and under root. And notice that this implies immediately mod X minus A is less than or equal to distance between these 2 points. And similarly, mod y minus b. Do all of you agree with this? Is it okay? Because we will need it. Okay. Look at the picture. I mean, this is all right. Analytically, it is easy because mod x minus a whole squared, you are adding something positive. Therefore, this will be greater than or equal to root of mod x minus a whole squared, which is mod x minus a. So this is the correct thing. But you should also have see that it pictorially. Okay, this is my AB, and I'm saying the distance between X and Y. Okay, and suppose that's equal to R. Okay, and then how much you can go in this direction, or how much you can go in this direction, Y direction, only R units. How many of you follow this? Because many people don't want to look at geometry. They want to manipulate only symbols. Okay. And next thing you should remember, we define what is meant by limit x, y going to a, b of f of x, y. We said it's equal to L if L is a real number. Therefore, I can form an interval L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon. This epsilon is the error which I can tolerate. Then what do I need? I have AB, then I want to say there is a delta positive. Given epsilon, there is a delta positive, so that's 0 less than, this is too much to write, okay, distance between XY, AB, this is not A minus B, AB, okay, is less than delta implies F of XY lies in this interval, L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon. That is same as in terms of inequalities, this. I'm just recalling the definition because if you remember, you gave the definition last time when I asked. Okay. We wanted to look at the function f of xy equal to defined to be x times y. And I wanted to say the limit xy going to ab of fxy. One was right too much is ab. Okay. We made a guess. Now we want a proof. Okay, last time we made a guess when I approached the point AB. This is the point AB. Approach it through any line, then I found out the limit was always AB. I reduced to one variable. That's a very important trick you should remember. Okay, reduce the problem to one variable. Okay, now if I want to prove that, what is that I should do? Okay, teachers and among books will say let epsilon be given, let delta equal to this. Okay, that is not the correct way in my opinion, because that's a mystery if you write that. Okay, as I said earlier, in the limit case, one variable case, I would not bother about epsilon delta. I will bother about estimating this. Epsilon delta will come later. So what is fxy? That is xy. What is L? AB. I have to estimate this. Right? Now, do you remember I said what do I mean by estimating some expression? Try to simplify that and make use of the hypothesis. What is the hypothesis? As xy approaches ab, if xy approaches ab, that means you see that mod x minus y, as I said, x minus a will be less than or equal to distance between xy and ab. Therefore, x approaches a also. That means I know how to estimate mod x minus a. Similarly, I know how to estimate mod y minus b. Do you understand that? If I say xy approaches ab, I know how to estimate distance between xy and ab. And hence, I know how to estimate the distance between x and a and y and b. Okay, so I have to make use of that here. Okay, in some sense I should bring x minus a or y minus b within this term and simplify. Okay, you see that we are thinking and then writing. We are simply not simply writing something and verifying. We know what why we want to do that. So what do I want to do? I want to write x as, write it as x minus a plus a. Then I got x minus a. Therefore, it's x minus a plus a times y minus ab. And this is equal to, you can see my x minus a into y plus ay minus ab. That is a into y minus b. How many of you get eureka? Do you get it? You see that? I wanted to estimate, but I know how to estimate mod x minus a and mod y minus b. So I got it. Now what inequality I should use here? Can somebody tell me? Quick.
Triangle inequality.
Triangle inequality. And therefore that will be less than or equal to modulus of this and modulus of that. But this I can write as modulus of y into modulus x minus a plus modulus of a into modulus of y minus b. Is that okay? You see that we are understanding and doing. We are not simply writing some manipulation, doing symbolic manipulation. Now, what do I want? Now I go back. Now you, I wanted to, if you give me an epsilon, I want to show this side mod fx minus l should be less than epsilon. If I make this last one less than epsilon, then this will automatically, the left side will be less than epsilon. Do you understand? So I want to make this term, the sum of these two terms should be less than epsilon. So we are all fair minded. What do you mean by this? I want to make sure this object is less than epsilon. Okay. So how can I achieve? I can achieve it in an uneven way. I can make sure the first term is less than epsilon by 10 and the second term is less than 9 epsilon by 10. Okay. Therefore the sum will be less than epsilon by 10. But we are all fair-minded people. So what I would like to do is I make sure this fellow is less than epsilon by 2 and this guy is also less than epsilon by 2. This is what I want to make sure. Do you understand this? Okay. Now how do I make sure? That means mod x minus a, I will just break and let me go. So I want mod y into mod x minus a should be less than epsilon by 2. What is that I want to find? I want to find a delta. What does delta deal with? It deals with x minus a and y minus b. If you want mod square, mod and mod or square of this plus square of this and square root. So don't get too much worried about. So the delta will involve mod x minus a and mod y minus b. Therefore, I would like to estimate mod x minus a to be epsilon by 2 times mod y. But your teacher will immediately jump at you. This y could be 0, right? But ignore your teacher for a while. Okay, now note, I have a very serious consideration. What is my serious consideration is the following. I have my AB, my XY is somewhere here. This is my AB. My AB, let me make it as a different color. This is my AB, this is my XY, right? Okay. Now, this y can be anything here. You understand? Therefore, this y keeps varying. This y, xy is at any point here. So, I cannot write epsilon by 2y. This is not a constant. That is my serious consideration. Do you understand that? So, what I would like to do is, if y has to be in this interval, is there any bound for y? If I replace mod y by some constant, let us say m, then I can say this fellow mod y into mod x minus a is less than or equal to m times mod x minus a. So if I make sure this fellow is less than epsilon by 2, this will automatically be less than epsilon by 2. And this is easy. This I have to only make sure mod x minus a is less than epsilon by 2m. You understand that? Now there is no variable. It's a constant, unlike this. How many of you appreciate this? Please say yes if you do that quick. Asaf, do you want to ask questions? Otherwise, say yes. And let me tell you again something which I said in the first or second lecture. Do not worry about whether I can do it my own or I will remember it. Don't. Your main primary aim here should be to think along with me to understand. Okay? Because everybody is obsessed with the exam and writing. Don't. Okay? Be obsessed with understanding. Okay? So I want to estimate this. Now, what kind of estimate I will know? At present, I don't have any delta. If I know delta, suppose this is delta, then I know mod x minus a will be less than or equal to distance between xy and ab, but that's less than delta. Therefore, mod x minus a or y, let us say y minus b, mod y minus b is less than delta. This will imply mod y will be less than mod b plus delta. You understand this? But I still have not found delta. So I can't use this delta. So what will I do? I will assume at present my delta A will be less than 1. This is at most 1. That is, I will allow my x and y in an open disk around this point AB with radius at most 1. You understand that? Therefore, my distance between x and y and A comma B, I am letting it to be less than 1. This is same as saying I am assuming my delta is less than 1 to start with. In particular, mod y minus b is less than 1. Therefore, mod y equal to mod y minus b plus b by triangle inequality mod y minus b plus 1. Therefore, it is less than 1 plus mod b. That's what I wrote. You understood that? You understand, all of you? Say yes if you understand. Priyanka, please mute your mic. Okay. But today it's very less. That means people have not making an effort to understand. Okay. If you don't make an thing, then I will go through very fast. Okay. Anyway, you are not going to make any attempt to understand. So why should I waste my time? Do you follow me? So the first thing is I will choose deltas less than 1. In that case, what I did is my xy will be at a distance less than 1 from AB. Therefore, in particular, mod y will be less than 1 plus mod b. Therefore, this term I can replace by, let me rewrite. Therefore, mod xy minus ab is less than or equal to mod y into mod x minus a plus mod a into y minus b. This I can replace by 1 plus mod b into mod x minus a. Right? And a, again, it could be 0. I want this term to be less than epsilon by 2. That means mod y minus b, I want it to be less than epsilon by 2 times mod a. But again, our teacher will say a could be 0. So we will replace this by mod a is less than 1 plus mod a times mod y minus b. Do you understand this? So I can make this less than epsilon by 2 and this less than epsilon by 2. How will I make it? That means mod x minus a should be less than epsilon by 2 into 1 plus mod b, and mod y minus b should be less than epsilon by 2 into 1 plus mod a. Right? And therefore, my delta, I want it to be minimum of 3 numbers now. 1, because I wanted this inequality. Mod y should be less than 1 plus mod b. For that, I needed delta to be less than 1. Next, this I want it to be less than epsilon by this whenever mod x minus a is less than delta. You understand that? Therefore, I want my delta to be less than this. And similarly, delta to be less than this number. Therefore, what do I want is epsilon by 2 into 1 plus mod b. Epsilon by 2 into 1 plus mod a. It's, I just went through all these things in very detail explaining how I will think solving the problem. Not just as a textbook proof, take delta equal to this and verify. I didn't do that. Okay. Therefore, if distance between x and y and ab is less than delta, then we proved mod xy minus ab is less than epsilon. If this is less than delta, that means mod x minus y is less than delta. That means mod x minus a is less than epsilon by 2 times 1 plus mod b. Because delta is minimum of these things. Yes, sir. Okay. Please go through it. Hello, please, Meetu, can you please mute your mic? I'll give you 15 seconds. Please go through it. As I said, do not worry about whether you can recall the argument. That's not total of importance. Okay. I'll be sending the PDF file. You can go through it again. What you should do is, did you understand how we kept on changing our goal? We kept on changing our estimate. Our goal is fixed. To arrive at the goal, we kept on changing the route. So let us quickly go through that. So if what is my delta? Delta is this. So you gave me an epsilon. The moment you gave me an epsilon, I prescribed what should be my delta. Then let us start with any xy, so the distance between x, y and a, b is less than delta. Then notice that mod x minus a will be less than delta. And mod y minus b will also be less than delta. In particular, mod x minus a and mod y minus b will be less than 1. Less than this number and less than this number. It will be less than any one of these three numbers. Now go to this. Now this is algebra. We did this. Now what did I do? Mod y, I already saw it is less than 1 plus mod b. Therefore, this is there. Now mod x minus a is less than delta, but delta is less than epsilon by 2 times 1 plus mod b. There I substitute this, I get epsilon by 2. And mod y minus b is less than delta, but delta is less than epsilon by 2 into 1 plus mod a. Therefore, I substitute here. This fellow is less than this number into y minus b, 1 plus mod a. Therefore, I get epsilon by 2. So, I got it. You see that? Verification is very easy. Okay. If I chose this delta somebody has given me, this verification is easy. It is like Mukesh Ambani, okay, making thousands of crores. And as an accountant, I only have to check his profit and loss balance sheet is correct for income tax purpose. That's it. My job is only to check the account. Okay. That is what you are doing. If I give you, this is your delta, what you did is you verified. Yes, things work out. But you did not discover, you did not earn the money. Whereas we earned the money, we found delta. How many of you appreciate? If you really appreciate, you can go to more. There's a clap sign. I would like to see that. How many of you really appreciate that? Okay, good. Can I go ahead now? Please clear your signs. Yes, and clap signs. Okay, can I go ahead now? At least 3 or 4 people can say yes so that I can go ahead. Good.
Yes.
Okay, good. You know, you don't know to say aloud. Okay. Now, my plan is for second year BSc students, I believe they are present here. I want them to get rid of the fear for limits. Okay. Just I'll work out some three, four typical cases and I will show you how I think rather than simply writing a proof. Okay. And as I said, do not worry about whether you can recall the proof, whether you can do on your own, whether you can write it. Do not. You slowly begin to think and when it's a matter of days, you will be able to do on your own. Okay, so let us look at various cases. Okay, so this is example number 2 now. This is x squared y by x squared plus y squared. This is my f of xy equal to this, where xy is not equal to 0. And equal to 0 if xy equal to 0. But as I said, to find the limit, I don't have to say the value of f at 0, 0. So what I want to do? Limit xy going to 0, 0 of fxy. So I already told you the trick. How many of you can do that? The first thing is I do not know the limit. Right? So I have to find the limit. What are the trick I said? Trick is reduce to one variable. How do I reduce to one variable? This is, it is 0. This is the point. There I can take y equal to tx or mx. I write tx, but if you want to do mx, it's also fine. Therefore, x squared, y equal to tx, therefore t into x, therefore it is tx cubed. Below, it will be x squared plus t squared x squared. What is this? I'm not taking the limit now. This is t x cubed. Here this is x squared into 1 plus t squared. So this is x. You understand this? Now t is fixed. Therefore t by 1 plus t squared is a constant times x. Now xy goes to 0. That in particular means x also goes to 0. Do you understand that? Therefore what should be the limit? What is your guess? Along every line passing through origin, I think the limit seems to be 0. How many of you understood this? This is x cubed. X squared cancelled. Therefore there is a x left in the numerator. T by 1 plus t squared, that's a constant because t is your m if you want. Do all of you understand? Okay. So along each of the line, whichever line I pass through, I found out the limit is 0. But that is not a proof. Like for xy equal to ab, for this, okay, that's not a proof. Right? We have to prove it, epsilon delta. So I want to give a proof for this. But this case very much easier than last case. So what do I want to do? I guess the limit is 0. Then I want to prove, estimate fxy minus 0. What is fxy? It is x squared y by x squared plus y squared. And minus 0, therefore this one. This is what I have to estimate. This is mod x squared, mod y, mod x squared plus, x squared plus y squared. I don't have to put a modulus because it's always positive, non-negative. It's positive because 0, 0 is not allowed. Do all of you understand this? Okay. Now, remember, what do I want? I want this person to be less than epsilon. That means I want this to be less than epsilon. Okay. Can anybody see that? How to make it? So I have x squared by x squared plus y squared into y mod y if you want. Notice that x squared by x plus 1 is less than or equal to 1. X squared by x squared plus y squared will be less than or equal to 1. Therefore, this is less than or equal to mod y. If I want to make this less than epsilon, it's enough if I make this less than epsilon. Okay, that means what? This mod y stands for mod y minus 0. That is the distance between y and 0. Therefore, I only have to take epsilon equal to be delta. Okay, therefore, if distance between xy and 0, 0 is less than, this is my delta, which is equal to epsilon, then mod fx my y minus 0 is less than epsilon. I will go through the proof. Now what I did is I created wealth. Okay. Now I will do accountant job. Accountant job is to check whether the details are correct. So you give me an epsilon. I choose my delta to be epsilon. You give me xy. So the distance between xy and 0, 0 is less than delta. Then I have to show mod fxy minus 0 is less than epsilon. I have to check this. But what is mod fxy minus 0? It is mod x squared y by x squared plus y squared. But that is mod x squared into mod y by x squared plus y squared. That is equal to this. but this is less than mod y, right? Since the distance between xy and 0, 0 is less than delta, that means mod x minus 0 and mod y minus 0, that is x minus a, y minus b. It's analog, right? Each one of them will be less than delta. You understand that? But what is delta? Delta is epsilon at most. Therefore, this fellow is less than delta, but that's equal to epsilon. So I got the proof. Okay. As I said again, do not be overwhelmed. Because if you are a beginner, I don't believe that you would have understood 100%, but that doesn't matter. Okay, you just, my main aim is to make you think and get it out of the fear. What all you have to do is you have to estimate, try to look for simpler way, how to simplify. Okay. Go through these three or four examples and then look at some textbook, do some more, another four or five examples, then you will know your limit. Okay, you don't have to worry about it any further. Okay, now let us look at one more example. Okay, the same thing, f of xy, it looks similar, but you will see what happens. X squared plus y squared when xy is not equal to 0, 0. Other, okay, I want to know what is the limit, whether limit exists. If it exists, what is it? Okay, notice that the earlier one was x squared times y, whereas I removed y here. It's only x squared by x squared plus y squared. Yeah? Is there any guess? So this is my point. Now let us assume I move along y equal to 0. That is y equal to tx, where t is 0. That is along this way to 0. Then y will be 0. Therefore, what is this f of xy? X squared by x squared. That is 1. So, limit along x-axis is 1. Do all of you understand? And what is the limit along y-axis? If I move along this way, then for this, x must be 0. Therefore, this will be 0 by 0 plus y squared. Remember, xy is not equal to 0, 0. Therefore, if x is 0, y cannot be 0. Therefore, this is positive. 0 by not 0. 0 by something positive, non-zero. Therefore, the limit will be 0 along the y-axis. How many of you understand? Please say yes if you understood. Okay, so limit along x-axis is 1, along y-axis is 0. So you will usually say immediately teacher will conclude the limit does, therefore the limit does not exist. Okay, but you can't prove like that. Even though it's textbooks say that and many teachers also say that, okay, the limit should be independent of the path, etc. This is not correct. Our definition, you see that now I am an accountant, my checking of the account should be as per the Indian government income tax rules. Okay, I cannot use something like a Panama Islands rules to compute the accounts. You understand? So my income tax rule says I have to use epsilon delta. So I can't do that. Okay, even though teachers and textbook will say the limits along different axis paths are different and hence the limit does not exist. Okay, that's quite okay if you want to live with it, and I'm sure you will also get full marks. But to be an honest, okay, auditor, I will do that. Okay, what I have to check, I want to say this shows my guess is now limit does not exist. Okay. This is my guess, even though that's allegedly a proof for many people. For me, it's a guess. Now, how do I prove that? Okay. Suppose I take epsilon equal to half. If the limit exists, okay, if the assume the limit exists, then epsilon equal to half, there is the delta positive, so that 0 less than distance between x1 y and 0 0 is less than delta should imply fxy minus some L should be less than epsilon, less than half. You understand that? Now let me look at something like f of half 0 minus L. This means along the x-axis. Along the x-axis, we found it is always 1. Therefore, this says 1 minus L is less than half. That means my 1 is here. The distance between 1 and L is less than half. That means it should lie between half and 3 halves. How many of you understand this? See, this is always 1. Right? And I can choose a delta, for example, delta by 2. Okay. Then delta by 2, comma 0, comma 0, 0. That distance will be less than delta by 2. You understand? Therefore, mod fx, this point, minus L should be less than epsilon. But my epsilon is half. You follow that? But this object is always 1. Therefore, 1 minus L should be less than half. That means my L should lie between half distance from 1. So I'll wait for 10-15 seconds. If you say yes, I'll go ahead. At least 10-15 people should say. Okay, good. You can remove this. And similarly, if I look at F0 delta by 2 minus L. Now remember F0 by delta by 2. This is a point on the y-axis. On the y-axis, we have found x is 0. Therefore, F of any point on the y-axis is always 0. Therefore, this means 0 minus L, that is mod L, should be less than half. You understand that? That means my L should lie between, this is my 0, this is my half, okay, and this is my 3 half. So according to the first condition, my L should lie here, but according to this condition, my L should lie between minus half to plus half. Okay, you see that? But it cannot be, because if it lies here, it should be less than half, strictly less than half. If it lies here, it should be strictly greater than half. That's a contradiction. Therefore, the limit does not exist. This is a slightly subtle proof, and it will help you if you go to your third year in MSc also. Okay? Please go through this. Do not lose heart. Okay? I took a lot of pain to explain, review this during discussion hours. All these things should be during, what is it called? Breakout rooms. All these examples, please do that in breakout rooms. Okay. Because of time constraint, okay, I don't want to spend time. Whereas in a typical MTTS classroom, I will make sure that almost everybody understands. But I don't have that luxury here. Now let's look at the fourth example. I'm giving a variety of tricks so that, you know, you will feel comfortable. This is again xy not equal to 0, 0. I want to find whether limit xy going to 0, 0 exists. X squared plus y squared. So what is your guess? Now I have taught you all tricks. What you should do? I am at a point 0, 0. Therefore, I should move along various lines passing through origin. What are the two important lines passing through origin? The x-axis and y-axis. Another important line is the diagonal line, y equal to x line. Do you understand what I'm saying? This is x-axis, this is y-axis, then this is the diagonal y equal to x line. Now try to see what happens to all these things. here y is 0, therefore this limit will be 0. And here x is 0, therefore the limit along the y-axis will be 0. Here y equal to x, therefore this will be x into x, that is x squared. Here it is x squared plus x squared. Therefore 2x squared. X squared by 2x squared will be half. Therefore if I move along this, I get limit as half. I move along this, I limit as half, 0. If I move along this, I get limit as 0. So what is the conclusion? Can somebody tell me quickly?
Limit doesn't exist.
Very good. But remember, we still have to prove that. Okay, but the proof is exactly similar. I don't want to inflict you with that kind of argument. That argument is good enough. Once you have learned one argument correctly, you can simply say similar argument works. And I will believe you, your teachers will believe you, and your university also will believe you. So that you will get full marks. No problem. Because finally, everybody is worried about. Now, I want to give one of the most testing examples. Remember, what did I say? If I want to find limit xy going to ab of fxy, okay, I do not know what it is. Then what I said was move along various lines. Okay, if all of them coincide, maybe that is a limit. One, maybe, but we have to prove it. And next one, what did I show? If along two distinct lines are passed as I move along, if the limits are distinct, we proved that the limit cannot exist, at least in one special case, but the same proof works in other cases. Do you understand these two statements? If xy moves along any line through to AB, if the limit exists, all of them coincide, then I hope the limit exists and it is equal to the common limit. It is a hope. It may or may not be true. And second thing, if I move along two distinct lines, for example, this is my AB, I move along this line, I move along some other line, and the limits are going to be distinct, they are different, then I know the limit does not exist. These are the two things we have seen, right? So many students believe if the limit along any line exists and all these limits are equal, the limit of the function exists. Do you understand? That's not true. We are want to give an example for that. Okay, so the example is this, f of xy. This is the last example, then I will move along. Okay, let me get it correct. X squared y by x power 4 plus y squared. Again, xy not equal to 0, 0. At all other points, this is defined. Okay, the first thing is, let us look at y equal to tx, that is your mx, along this line, whether the limit exists. Then in that case, what happens? X to come out tx. That is going to be t squared into tx. Sorry. X squared into tx. Therefore, it's t into x cubed. Do you understand? X squared and tx. Therefore, t into x cubed. By, this is x power 4. This is t squared x squared. That is going to be x squared t into x by, now x squared is common, I take x squared into 1 plus t squared. This is x squared into t squared. Do all of you understand this? Is my algebra correct? This x squared cancel. Now notice that t by x squared plus t squared, that is less than or equal to 1. Okay, this I don't have to worry about. X squared plus t squared. Okay, this is modulus I have to put. And this is always positive. Okay, this is less than or equal to mod t by mod t squared. That is less than or equal to 1 by mod t. Okay, this is a constant. Okay, this is some constant times x. You follow that? After estimating in modulus, I get this. But as x goes to 0, then this goes to 0. Therefore, the limit along the line y equal to tx or mx exists and it is 0 all for every slope m. Okay, are you convinced? At least 40-50%. So limit of f along t y equal to mx exists and it is zero. Therefore I may hope L must be zero. The limit exists and limit must be zero, but that's wrong. Okay, it doesn't. Let us look at the function. It is let me write x squared y. Yeah, let me go back. X squared y by x power 4 by y squared. Now, instead of the usual path, can you think of some path along which you can approach 0, 0? I'm sure you would have seen it in your calculus course already. See, there is x squared here, x power 4. Here is y squared. So what do you think I will do? This is just algebra.
Y equals to mx squared.
Yeah, I know that. You would have seen it. So it is x power 4 by x power 4 plus x power 4. That is 1 by 2. You see that? Along this, the limit is half. This is y equal to x squared. You understood that? Okay. Now again, you should ask, why? So along this path, the parabolic path, I proved the limit of f along y equal to x squared is half. Okay, so what? How do I know the limit does not exist? I still need a proof. Okay, but that proof is easy, because if you start with any delta, okay, suppose this is delta, okay, start with any x and y, then I can find a point of the parabola which is near here. Okay, its distance will be, okay, the value here will be half. Whereas if I take a point here, that is also within the delta distance from zero, but the value here is zero. You follow that? Therefore, if I take my epsilon equal to 1 by 4, whatever delta you give me, okay, fxy, if x and y lie on this parabola, will take the value half, okay, and that cannot be happen. Okay, it's exactly the same argument, similar argument which I gave for was, I don't remember which case, I think the second or third case I did. Okay, yeah, right here. Okay, the argument is something very similar to that. I still have to prove the limit does not exist. Okay, but typically the textbooks and teachers will say along the lines the limits exist, they are all equal, but along the parabolic path, the limit is different from the limit along the line. Therefore, the limit does not exist. All of us will accept. So that puts, okay, we are happy. Everybody accepts that. Okay. Now I'll give you some two or three exercises as an assignment later. Okay, but because if I give you, then you will try to use that or discuss that in the discussion hour or breakout room. I don't want you to do that. I want you to understand all these five examples, because this kind of epsilon delta, very carefully thinking and working out. Notice that we are discovering the delta. We are not stipulating delta and then verifying it works. Okay, we are creators. Is it all right? Hereafter, you can read any book and your teacher's thing, and you should be able to follow somewhat easily, my guess. If you say that, I'll be happy. Okay. Right. Can I move on to something else now? I have just about 10, let us say, we started around 35, 37. So I have another 15 minutes. Yeah. Please tell me, yes, if I can go ahead with something else, or do you want anything more? If so, okay, I'm going to go out of the limit now. Okay. So if you want me to tell you something more about limits, or if you have any doubts, please ask me now. I will give you 15 seconds. Okay. Just to test you, suppose I give something like this. Okay. What should be the domain of this function? Can somebody tell me? Is it defined outside 0, 0 origin?
X should not be equal to y.
That's it. Okay.
In x and y,
x
should,
and
be
y should be positive.
Greater than equal to 0.
Greater than 0.
Positive.
Yes, positive numbers.
Yes, sir. X and y must be positive.
Yeah, x and y must be positive. Then only I can talk of square root, right? So what does that mean? This function is defined where then? What should
positive
be
real number line?
Huh?
Positive real number line.
Remember, it's a function of two variables. So
first
in R2, you have to tell me.
Yes, sir. First.
X and first y belong to R square with the condition x and y must not be equal and x and y should be greater than zero.
So this must be the domain. You understand? And this line y equal to x should not be there, because if y equal to x, then this becomes zero, right? Am I correct? Do all of you understand? Huh? This should not be zero. That means root of x should not be equal to root of y. That happens if only if x equal to y. Remember, they are positive. Right, therefore that line should be included, and I should be able to talk about root of x. That means x must be positive, similarly y. So it should be in the first quadrant and this. Yeah. Now I don't want to go to the limit. So suppose I want to talk about limit x y going to 0, 0. Okay, what should be your first impulse? How will you solve this problem? If you are, you might have already done in your calculus course, then I will be at a loss, but you should learn. What should be the trick? This is from your high school. From your high school, whenever there is a fraction, clear up the fraction.
Rationalize.
Rationalize, right. You multiply both numerator by root x plus root y and so on. You understand? So these are the few tricks. Now suppose I give something like a problem. F of x y equal to sine x y. Sine xy by xy. If you say this, if I want to talk about limit xy, I don't know whether it exists or not exists. Let me not worry about it. I want to talk about the limit of this function. The moment you see this expression, what should come to your mind? See, this is how you have to learn to solve problems. Whereas what you do is, if the teacher solves a problem, you learn to, you try to learn it by heart.
So we can take xy equals to some constant.
No, you can't take. X and y are varying. How can I take xy equal to constant? If I take xy equal to constant, yes.
So xy equals to, so we can take xy equals to some other variable. Say u.
No, but my question is this. This only says your teacher had solved this problem. You are giving me the answer. Am I right? Yes or no?
So please. The first thing that comes to my mind would be limit x tends to 0 sine x by x is
very good.
Is 1.
That's the answer. That's exactly what I wanted. Sine x by x, all of you know, this is the calculus starting, right? So somehow I should reduce it to this one. So what will I do? Make it t and substitute the variable t equal to x. Very good. See, these are the standard tricks. Now I think all of you, see, now what you know is this kind of gimmicks is what you remember. Do you understand the difference? You know the gimmicks. Rationalize, do this, that. But what you should remember is, go back and scratch your memory. Try to see whether it's something I've seen related, whether I can make use of it. And then whether I can give a rigorous argument. This is what I have been teaching. My request is, please mute your mics. All. Okay. Now, I want to go on to now differentiation. of functions from two variables to real variable, functions from R2 to R. Okay, for that I want to spend some time, which we already did, okay, for functions from R to R. Do you remember that? What did we do? I fix a point A. I want to show F is differentiable at A. It may be some interval also, I don't care. Then what did I do? Our high school thing was limit extends to A, RH goes to 0 of fx minus fa by x minus a, or limit h tends to 0 of f of a plus h minus f of a by h. But we understood what is the definition of a limit, then we tried to reformulate. What did we find? If I write fx equal to y and f of x plus h equal to y plus k, then h is called increment in the independent variable and k is called the increment in the dependent variable. That where f of a plus h minus f of a is the increment in the dependent variable, and a plus h minus a, which is h, is the increment in the independent variable. The variable is y, that namely f of x, that depends on x. That is why it's dependent variable. X is independent. I can put any x there. This is h. Okay. Then what did we do? We said that I wanted to approximate f of a plus h by means of a first degree polynomial in, let us say, something lambda in the increment in the independent variable, lambda times h. In terms of x, I wrote it as f of a plus lambda times x minus a. Do you understand this? I'm just recalling because I want you to arrive at the definition for functions from R2 to R. Let us see how many of you can get it. Then what did I do? If I want to say it's approximately equal to, then I am making an error. What is the error? Error is fx minus fa minus lambda x minus a. Then what do I want? This error should go to zero faster than which error? This one, the increment going to zero. That means this limit has mod x minus a, that is x going to a, this should be zero. This all we have seen. How many of you recall this? We have seen it. Please say yes if you recall this. Now, I want you to come up with a definition now. Let us see whether we succeed. So, I have the point AB. Okay. Now, I have something. Okay. This is my point AB. I have point XY here. Okay. This is, oh, this circle yet. This is my point x comma y. This is the point a comma b, right? Then let us assume the function is defined here. Then I want fxy. I want to say fxy is differentiable at the point a comma b. This is my a comma b. So what do you think? Let's go back. If you understand this definition, okay, I'll give you 15 seconds to all of you. I don't want to hear the answer from anybody orally at present. All of you, 84 of you, including me, should think what should be the definition. Go back to one variable case, try to see whether you can make sense. Try to mimic the first one variable case to say f is differentiable at AB. Now, can somebody tell me what should be the definition? No, you don't have to write in symbols. Okay, just say it qualitatively in ordinary text. If I when I want to say f is differentiable at the point AB, what should I do? Nobody? That's very surprising.
Sir, f of a plus h comma 0 should be...
There is nothing like 0, etc. Where is 0? Please, if you are a third year student or second year student, you had already seen partial derivatives, do not come okay with that. Okay? You see that? That's a problem. People who have learned, they try to recall and say something, then think along with me and try to say that. So it's always easier to teach somebody who has not been taught earlier. I want you to simply say in text, paraphrase. I don't want symbols. I don't want mathematics. I should be able to approximate f of x, y by means of first degree polynomial in what? In the increment in the independent variable. What is the increment? Increment is xy minus ab, that is x minus a, y minus b. Therefore, I must be able to approximate this by a first degree polynomial in the variable is x minus a and y minus b. And the error should go to zero faster than this is distance between x and a. Therefore, it must be distance between xy and ab. Okay, do not worry about if you understood at least 30% of what I said orally, we are on the right path. Let me repeat. Okay, what I would like to say is f is differentiable at AB. If I can approximate the function f by a first degree polynomial of the form f of AB plus first degree polynomial in x minus a and y minus b. These are the increment in place of x minus a, I'm writing x minus a and y minus a. Okay, these are the increment in the independent variable. Okay, and if I say I got an approximation, then I am making an error. Then what should I demand? The limit as x tends to a and y tends to b, that is x, y going to a, b, f of x minus its first degree polynomial divided by mod x minus a, I will be replacing by distance between x, y and a, b. That should be zero. Okay. Those who understood at least 30% say yes. We will work out all these details one by one. But the point is, this is how any scientist, any mathematician works. They don't come with this is the precise theorem. They have think, they understand, try to vaguely formulate and then make it rigorous step by step. Okay, this kind of discovery is missing. Okay, scientific temper cannot come if I learn it by heart. Only if I'm ready to think, it will come. Can all of you say yes? Not all of you, those who understood 30%. Okay, that's pretty good. Thank you. Now we have to understand, what did I say? It should be approximated by means of first degree polynomial. The constant term, yes, like f of a, f of a, b. Then I wanted first degree polynomial x minus a and y minus b. What do I mean by a first degree polynomial in two variables x and y? Forget x minus a, x minus b. These are the two variables. What do I mean by first degree polynomial in the variables x and y? Can somebody come up with an answer? The first degree polynomial in one variable will be some a0 plus a1x. If you allow constant term. You understood? Now there are two variables. What should be the first degree polynomial then in these variables? Yes? If somebody knows the answer or guess, it doesn't have to be an answer. If you have a guess, please let me know. What should be the... It is c1x plus c2y. That's it. Here it is c0. If it's a constant term is allowed, it's c0 plus c1x. But the first degree polynomial f of a b constant is already written. Therefore, I only have to say this is sum c1 into x minus a plus c2 into y minus b. Do all of you understand this now? Say yes if you understand. You follow that? Okay. Next, I have to go back. I'm going to stop in a minute. So, but then I have to say, if it is differentiable, it has to be approximated by a positive degree polynomial. I know that, but that's not enough. I have to say, look at the error term. I have to make sure it goes faster than something else. So what is the error term? That is f of xy minus f of ab minus c1 into x minus a minus c2 into x minus a. This is the thing. This is the error that should go faster than xy going to ab. That means distance between x and y. What is that? That is x minus a whole squared plus y minus b whole squared. The limit xy going to ab, this should be zero. This is exactly analogous to the one variable case. Okay. So the limit we understand. So if you give me an epsilon positive, then there is a delta positive such that zero less than xy and ab less than delta should imply this in modulus should be less than epsilon. That means f of xy minus f of ab minus c1 into x minus a minus c2 into, sorry, why nobody corrected me? This y minus b. Did I earlier write properly here? Yeah, y minus b. That means not many of you are paying attention. Okay. This is, then if I can find, therefore f is differentiable at AB, what is unknown? If f is differentiable at AB, if the unknown, I want the first degree polynomial. For the first degree polynomial, constant term is known to me. Therefore, what are unknown? If there exists real numbers C1 and C2, such that for every epsilon positive, there is a delta positive, such that distance between xy and ab is less than delta implies fxy minus f of ab minus c1 times x minus a. This first degree polynomial will be less than epsilon into this. Okay, we'll stop here. Okay. Tomorrow I will start with this again, but please review this. I think I more or less stopped about 1 hour, 2 minutes or 3 minutes. Please, I will send the PDF file to you soon. And my request to you is I worked out 4 or 5 examples. Even those who had already done second year BSc and are in final year BSc, my request to them is if you want to master, please go through all of them again. Okay. And also those third year students should look back at the definition of differentiability of a function from R2 to R. You see that we did not simply write definition is this. Be motivated. It's possible you might have seen slightly different definitions also. Do not worry. All these definitions are equivalent. I will say how tomorrow. Okay.